newest KICP fellow. She started the 1st of January here. She got her PhD at Yale working with Dan McKinsey, working on the Lux experiment, which is what she's going to talk about today. And the reason you probably haven't seen her around is because although she started the 1st of January, that week she got on a plane to go to the South Pole. And she just got back 2 nights ago. So you'll be seeing more of Nicole in the future, but today we're going to hear about her thesis experiment, which is Lux.
All right. Thank you, Abby, for the introduction.
Microphone.
Can everyone hear me?
Turn that on. All right. Now okay. Can everyone hear me? Perfect. So I'm going to start today by giving just a very, very, very extremely brief overview of the dark matter problem. I'm going to talk about the Lux experiment, what it is, how it works, how it's designed, how it operates. I'm going to speak about our first big science run that took place in 2013. And then I'm going to talk about the result that just recently came out in December, some new improved limits from our 2013 data set. So it's a very exciting time right now, and I'm excited to be speaking about it. So dark matter, what is it? Why is it a problem? Even though the standard model does a very good job of describing the universe around us that we can see, there are a bunch of parts missing. We can tell through astronomical observations, through observations of galactic rotation curves, gravitational lensing, the CMB, baryon acoustic oscillations. We have a whole lot of evidence from a whole lot of different places that say that the standard model is not all there is. Today we think that 26% of all of the energy density in the universe is made up of dark matter.
25.9.
I like to round. We think that 69.1% of the energy density in the universe is made up of dark energy, which we know even less about than dark matter, and only about 4.8% of the energy density in the universe is made up of the normal baryons that we experience in our day-to-day life. So we don't know much about it. What do we know about it? We know that dark matter interacts gravitationally. We know that it interacts only very weakly with normal matter, or we would have been able to see it by now. We know it has to be electrically neutral. We know it has to be stable, or it would have decayed away by now. We know it has to be non-relativistic. We can tell this through observations of large-scale structure and the general clumpiness of the universe. And we think it requires some kind of beyond-standard model physics. So the most promising candidate that we've come up with so far is the WIMP, or the Weakly Interacting Massive Particle. And we think that this WIMP was initially in thermal equilibrium with standard model particles towards the beginning of the universe. And it just annihilated back and forth between being a WIMP and between standard model particles. Then freeze out occurs as the interaction rate drops below the universe's expansion rate. So that kind of fixes the density of dark matter particles in the universe. And the WIMP miracle, I don't like the word miracle, but that's what they call it. The WIMP miracle is that if you put into this calculation of the abundance it freeze out, if you put in a WIMP mass of about 100 GeV, which is nice, there are a lot of standard model particles that are on the order of GeV, tens of GeV, 100 GeV. And if you put in an interaction cross-section that is approximately on the order of the weak scale, then you get almost exactly the relic abundance that we see in the universe today. So this is kind of nice and convenient. It's a nice place to start looking for what dark matter could be. The other nice thing about WIMPs is that they arise naturally in many theories that have been proposed as extensions to the standard model. The big one is supersymmetry. I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about that. There are three main detection strategies that we use in order to look for WIMPs. The one that I have spent most of my time working on is direct detection. So basically, as the Earth travels through the galactic dark matter halo, you get sort of a wind of WIMPs incident upon the Earth. And so in direct detection, what you look for is this flux of WIMPs scattering off some sort of laboratory target that consists of just standard model particles, some sort of heavy nuclei. If you look at this diagram, this is a Feynman diagram that can be read in pretty much any direction you want to.
So direct detection, you read from left to right, so there's a wimp coming in, interacting in a standard model particle. We don't know the details of that interaction, but then you get a standard model particle, I guess that guy coming out, and you get a wimp coming out, so it's just a scatter. Indirect detection occurs when you read this Feynman diagram from top to bottom. You get two wimps coming in, they annihilate somehow, and then you end up with standard model particles coming out. So in indirect detection, we look for these standard model final state particles, such as gammas or neutrinos, resulting from dark matter annihilations or dark matter decays. And then last but not least, we can look for new particles in colliders, and that's if you read this Feynman diagram from bottom to top. You get standard model particles colliding together very energetically, and you get some sort of new particle coming out, and it is possible, it is likely, that if we see new particles produced in colliders, some of those particles might have the right properties to explain part or all of the observed dark matter abundance that we see today. This is the mappiest slide that I'm going to show, but I wanted to show this anyway because this is the equation that basically governs all of direct detection. So this right here is the differential event rate with respect to recoil energy of wimps coming in and interacting off of the target in the laboratory. So this event rate is proportional to basically the number density of wimps that you get, the number density of nuclei in your target, and then you average over the wimp velocity distribution. This number here, the F of B, is the wimp velocity distribution, and that depends on your Halo model that contains all the astrophysics. And then this number, this D sigma with respect to energy, depends on the particle physics of how the wimp interacts with your nucleus. Where was I? Yeah, so you take this number, this contains all the particle physics, this contains all the astrophysics. For the velocity distribution, we typically use a Maxwellian halo model, truncated at the galactic escape velocity, and we account for the Earth's motion through the galaxy. We account for annual modulations, Earth travels around the sun, and so on. This number, this cross-section, is proportional to the scattering amplitude, which in turn is proportional to a squared, so the size of the nucleus for spin-independent interactions. It's proportional to the spin content of the nucleus for spin-dependent interactions, which I'll mention briefly, but I won't go into detail with. And in each case, there is a form factor that contains all the nuclear physics that contains the distribution of protons and neutrons within your target nucleus. And that depends on the nucleus that you're looking at. That depends also on the type of interaction that you're looking at. So it can be different for spin-independent and spin-dependent interactions. So that's a lot of equations. When you have a wimp scattering inside a detector, what does the signal actually look like? So what we expect a very, very low event rate for our signal. We expect less than about one wimp per kilogram per year to be seen in a detector. We expect pretty low recoil energies on the order of about 10 keV. We expect wimps to scatter elastically off of nuclei because they're electrically neutral. They're not going to interact with the electron cloud around their target atom. So neutrons, which are also electrically neutral, are going to be an indistinguishable background. I'll talk a little bit later about how you shield against neutrons and how you tell the difference between different kinds of backgrounds. Gammas and electrons, on the other hand, scatter off of the electrons in your target. So what that means is if we can distinguish between electron recoils and nuclear recoils, we have a nice way of getting rid of the bulk of the background in our detector. So when you have a wimp coming in and scattering off of the target nucleus, energy is deposited into the target in one or more of three different ways. It can be deposited as heat or photons. It can be deposited as scintillation light from the excitation of the target, or it can ionize the target and produce a charge signal. So LUX and other noble liquid detectors use these last two channels here. We look at the light signal and we look at the charge signal from events happening within the detector.
example of an experiment that looks at a photon signal would be something like super CDMS, which uses silicon and germanium crystals. Something like KU or PICO is a bubble chamber that also looks for heat deposited, but that signal is different because it's a bubble chamber. So now let's talk specifically about xenon, which is what Lux consists of. Xenon is very nice because it's very high density, so you can build very large mass detectors in a small and decently manageable volume. It's nice because it has a very high atomic mass, so you take advantage of a square enhancement for the spin-independent cross-section. And it's also very easy to get a signal out of your detector. Xenon scintillates very brightly in the near UV with fast response time, so it's easy to get a light signal out. Xenon has very good electron mobility, and very long electron drift lengths have been demonstrated, so it's easy to get a charge signal out. Those are the two different channels that we're interested in. Xenon is a very clean substance. There are no long-lived intrinsic radioactive backgrounds. You have xenon-127 and like metastable xenon-129, and you have a couple of radioactive isotopes, but all of these things decay away with a time constant of days or a month at the most. Another nice thing about xenon is it's got a large natural abundance of odd isotopes, so you have spin-dependent sensitivity as well. You can look for different kinds of interactions within xenon. It's also nice because it is very scalable. Something like super CDMS, it's very hard to make large, pure crystals, whereas xenon, because it's a liquid, you can just sort of have a big tank and fill it up. So that's nice. There's not surfaces within the detector that you have to worry about. And the last very nice thing about xenon is that it tends to attenuate gammas and neutrons within just a few centimeters of the edge of the detector. So you get this self-shielding where events near the edge are attenuated, and the outermost layer of xenon in a large detector protects the innermost layer from external backgrounds. So this self-shielding is really, really nice. The way that Lux works, Lux is a dual phase time projection chamber. So what we do is we cool our large xenon target right down to its condensation point, so you get the bulk consisting of liquid, but a very thin layer of gas on top. It's kind of interesting because you have this atmosphere, you can get sort of weather going on in there and everything. It's very interesting. But then what happens is an incident particle coming in and interacting with a xenon atom inside the bulk is going to produce an initial flash of scintillation, which we call primary or S1 light. And then any ionization electrons that are produced inside the target, we drift those upwards by applying an electric field, and we extract them into the gas phase where they're accelerated and they're caused to scintillate again, which we call proportional or S2 light. So both scintillation light from the scintillation channel, is detected by photomultiplier tubes on the bottom and top of the detector, and the charge signal is converted to light and again detected by photomultiplier tubes on the bottom and the top of the detector. So every event that happens, well, almost every event that happens, consists of two pulses separated by some distance in time. And what you do is you look at the timing between the first pulse, the S1, and the S2 pulse, and that gives the Z position or the depth of your interaction site of the detector. And then the hit patterns on the PMTs, you can use a centroid method or you can use any number of methods to determine the XY position of the interaction from the hit pattern on the PMTs. The other nice thing about looking at these two different channels is the relative size of the S2 compared to the S1 pulse gives you some information about the kind of particle that came in your detector. So nuclear recoils tend to produce very dense tracks in the xenon. Electron recoils tend to produce less dense tracks. And the ratio of the two pulses tends to be much greater for electronic recoils than for nuclear recoils. So this gives us a way to discriminate against most of our background. This is an actual event from lux. This is a low energy gamma. The S1 is typically much smaller and spikier than the S2. And then the S2 is this large, more Gaussian-shaped pulse, but each event that we consider in our detector consists of two pulses that look essentially like this. So this is a picture of our collaboration. It consists of over 100 scientists from a dozen different institutions. This was one of our recent collaboration meetings last summer out in Leeds, South Dakota, where the detector is located. A little bit more about where Lux is situated. It is located in the old Homestead gold mine, which was decommissioned in 2000 when the price of gold dropped. And then in 2006-2007, it was revamped to be dedicated specifically for scientific research. Lux is located 4,850 feet below the surface of the Earth. And we do this because by putting it under the ground like this, we can reduce the muon flux and the cosmic ray flux, and that gets rid of a lot of the backgrounds in our detector. A lot of particle physics experiments like to be situated underground. The other notable thing about where Lux is located is that it is located where Ray Davis performed his famous solar neutrino experiment. So there's a lot of history in that area that I think is kind of neat. This is a schematic of Lux. So Lux consists of 370 kilograms of xenon total. The active volume is 250 kilograms. The fiducial volume that we use is 118 kilograms. This is where the active volume is located. As I mentioned a couple slides ago, it is viewed from the bottom up and from the top down by two arrays consisting of 122 PMTs total. Just inside the two arrays of PMTs are a set of wire grids that establish the electric fields within the detector. They establish both the drift field to drift the charge up and the extraction field, which is separately tunable from the drift field, in order to pull the electrons into the gaseous part of the detector. The main volume is walled by reflective Teflon panels, which we put in there to ensure the best possible light collection. And the whole thing is kept cool by a set of thermosiphons. So a thermosiphon is basically a convective loop. It's a closed convective loop of nitrogen. The nitrogen is exposed to one of the copper plates that walls the top and bottom of the detector. And the nitrogen is allowed to boil off and it pulls heat outside of the detector when it does that. So it boils off and then it's recondensed and then it boils off again. And just continuously draws heat out of the detector. The whole detector is deployed into two ultra radio pure titanium cryostats, and it is then deployed, the whole thing inside the cryostats, into a 300 ton water tank that acts as shielding and is separately instrumented with PMTs to serve as a muon veto. Here are some photographs of some of the components that I mentioned on the past slide. I have lots of pictures of the PMTs because they're very photogenic. I'll start up here in the upper right. This is a bottom-up view of the inside of the main volume of the detector with the PMTs right here, and you can see the Teflon panels that surround the main volume. This right here is a similar view with the Teflon panels removed, and these are an array of field rings that we deploy between the wire grids in order to make sure the electric fields are uniform. This is a side view, again with the Teflon panels, and you can see the field rings. Over here is an image of the wire grids that we use, which, depending on the grid, have wires of between 50 and 200 microns and a pitch of between 5 millimeters and a centimeter, again, depending on which grid. And so the grids have been optimized to provide as uniform as possible an electric field while still maintaining as good of transparency as possible so we get the good light collection. And that's just another view of the PMTs. A couple more words about the PMTs. The PMTs that we used were designed by Hamamatsu specifically for low background kind of physics experiments just like this. They were designed to operate at cryogenic temperatures, so again, perfect for liquid xenon. They were designed to detect very efficiently the characteristic 175 nanometer light that comes out of excited xenon that we're trying to detect. This is nice because most PMTs sort of operate in the visible range. These go a little bit lower. And this is also a nice wavelength because unlike something like argon, you don't have to have a wavelength shifter in order to have light detectable by PMTs. So they've got a big diameter, so you get good surface area coverage. And they've got very good detection efficiency, 33% quantum efficiency, 90% collection efficiency for an overall 30% efficiency, which is very, very good. They've got an overall gain of 3 × 10⁶. And they were designed, I think I said this already, but they were designed to be extremely low radioactivity. Even with these numbers, the PMTs are sort of the dominant source of radioactivity of the detector. So this is about the best you're going to do with a photomultiplier tube. So this is a subsystem that I spent a lot of my time in particular working on. In order to prevent your charge signal in your detector from getting captured by electronegative impurities, the xenon has to be circulated continuously outside of the main volume through an external purifier that is located at ambient temperatures or a little bit above, and then it gets circulated through this purifier and then back into your main volume. So we've got to do this continuously. We use for this a heated zirconium getter in order to remove things like oxygen and nitrogen that are going to capture your charge signal. And we use a set of KNF circulation pumps that are able to circulate over 250 kilograms of xenon per day through the purifier and back into the detector. So this corresponds to a turnover of 1 lux worth of xenon about every 1.7 days. So that does pretty well. We have also a sampling system that is, it's a RGA-based, and it uses a cold trap to freeze out xenon so that very, very low amounts of impurities can be detected. Our sampling system is sensitive to 0.7 ppb of oxygen and 0.5 ppt of krypton, and we're able to just take samples in situ as we're running. Last but not least, I mentioned the thermosiphons a couple of slides ago. Our thermosiphons that we have 4 thermosiphons, a large one on top, a large one on bottom, and 2 smaller ones on the side for fine temperature control. Our thermosiphons produce up to 200 watts of cooling power, and they work in conjunction with 3 different heat exchangers directly in the circulation path that reduce our overall cooling power required by 98%. So this is a picture of our xenon handling and purification systems. I don't know, that might be kind of hard to see. You can see this guy right here is our getter that we use. This guy right here is our sampling system. I don't know, you can't see much detail there. That's some electronics. That's where the circulation pumps live. So overall, performance of this system, during our first underground run, we were able to keep the detector pressure stable to within 1%, and our detector temperature stable to within 0.2 Kelvin during normal operations. So now I'm going to talk about our calibration systems. So this is sort of adjacent to and alongside the circulation and xenon handling systems. We spent a lot of time on LUX to develop radioactive sources that could be doped directly into the xenon flow path so that they could sort of flow and diffuse and be distributed uniformly throughout the entire active volume. And the reason that you want to do this is because while the self-shielding properties of xenon help you out a lot when it comes to getting rid of external backgrounds, they hurt you a lot when it comes to trying to get calibrations, right? You want your calibration source to light up the middle of your detector. So what we did was we developed a krypton 83M source. We attach it to the circulation system so we can just flush the xenon right through. And the krypton from the source then gets diffused throughout the entire active volume of the detector. So
So krypton is nice because it's easy to distinguish it from other events. You get this sort of characteristic double S1 shape because it produces two conversion electrons, one after another. You get this 32 kV and 9 kV. And then the S2, it's, you can't really resolve the two separate peaks in the S2, but the S1 is very obvious what your krypton event is. It's also nice because this 41 kV krypton signal is above the Wendt search region that we use for most of our physics analyses. The other things about the krypton that I should mention are that the lifetime of the krypton is just a couple hours, so it decays away very quickly. You're not polluting your detector. When you put krypton into your detector, you just wait for it to decay away after a day. And we use this for a number of different calibrations. We use this for position-based S1 and S2 corrections. We use this to determine our fiducial volume. And we use this to measure our electron lifetime inside the detector. Throughout the course of our first underground run, we did approximately one krypton injection per week. And as a nice bonus, you can see the xenon flow in real time. And we actually use this as a diagnostic tool. During our first surface run, there was a piece of disconnected plumbing that we couldn't figure out where it was. But we were able to diagnose this with a krypton injection. Another source that we put internally into the detector just by plumbing it directly into the xenon flow is tritium. Tritium is really nice because we can use it to calibrate our electron recoil band. I mentioned that the krypton events that we look at in our calibrations lie pretty far above our Wendt search region that we use. Tritium, on the other hand, is a beta source with an 18 kV endpoint, and it goes all the way down. So it's just this sort of nice, like the mean is like 5.9 kV, but it's really nice for calibrating your detector down to low energies. The problem with tritium is that it has a 12-year half-life. So you don't want to put a whole bunch of stuff into your detector that you can't get back out. But the trick that we use here is instead of plain tritium, we use tritiated methane, which is pulled out very nicely by our getter. And we studied this extensively. We didn't put any tritium in until after the end of the run just to make sure we could get it out. Turns out the getter pulls it out with a few hour time constant, which is even better than the 1.7 days that I cited for turning over a detector size volume of xenon through the getter. And we don't want to just calibrate our electron recoil band, we also want to calibrate our nuclear recoil band. For the initial analysis of our 2013 data set for our first underground run, we used a set of external neutron sources. So we have six acrylic source tubes that extend down inside our water tank adjacent to the main cryostat for the Lux detector. And we just sort of deploy the sources. You can put any source that you want in there. You just sort of deploy it down on essentially a fishing reel right next to the detector, and then you can look at the events of the detector. For this, we have self-shielding fighting against us. So this is not the greatest. But regardless, we were able to get good results from using external EMP and Californium 252 sources to calibrate our nuclear recoil events inside the detector. So this is just a plot of simulated nuclear recoil data compared with actual nuclear recoil data that we took. And it matches pretty well. But I will say some more words about nuclear recoil calibrations later. So this is an overview of our first Wendt search run. In January 2013, that sort of marks the beginning of our run. We had everything installed underground. The previous summer, we moved the detector from a surface laboratory into the Davis cavern underground. And then we sort of spent the fall and the winter putting everything back together. January, we officially started our detector cool down. Mid-February, we had all of the xenon condensed into the detector. We had a couple of tests that we did in order to finalize our run parameters. And then we collected Wendt search data from April to the end of August 2013. Overall, during this time, we had a 95% data taking efficiency. These lips that you see on this graph
were usually due to power outages because of inclement weather in the area. But even taking that into account, we had a very high data taking efficiency during this time. So overall, we collected 85.3 live days of web search data. So here is our first underground run by the numbers, or I will point out the pictures first. This is the bottom level of the Davis Cavern. This is the outside of the water tank into which Lux is deployed. And this is a picture of Lux inside the water tank. This is the cryostat. You can see the, maybe you can't see that so well, but you can see the source tubes deployed down next to the cryostat. And you can see the large PMTs that we use for a muon veto inside the water tank. So the relevant numbers for our run are overall, for our xenon purity, we were able to achieve electron drift lengths on the order of a meter, between 87 and 135 centimeters. Compared to the actual available drift length inside the detector is only 49 centimeters tall, so that's over twice the height of the detector. Our drift field that we were able to establish with our grids was 181 volts per centimeter. With this, we were able to achieve 99.6% electron recoil discrimination. Our overall light collection efficiency, when you take into account the detector geometry, the efficiency of the PMTs, and all of that, was 14%. Our fiducial mass was determined to be 118 kilograms, and we selected this based on looking at alpha backgrounds from the walls. And for our web search window, we selected an energy range of 3 to 25 kV.
So I noticed, I don't know if you know this, but right here at the PMTs for your muon veto, it looks pretty sparse spatially. So how do you write muons coming in from, how far is it in each of the muons, or how does that work out? I was just expecting you to have certain more coverage.
The muons produce a lot of light, and I haven't worked with the muon system much, but I believe the light is kind of diffuse, so it's you can see it.
It's pretty well.
Yeah. This is a thing that was installed for run 3, which is our first underground run, and I'm deliberately not saying that much about it because we were sort of testing it to get it operational, and it is operational now, but wasn't at the time. So this is data from our electron recoil calibrations and our nuclear recoil calibrations that we took during run 3. And you can see the very good separation. This is on the y-axis, I'm plotting the ratio of S2 versus S1. On the x-axis, I'm plotting S1. And this just shows the separation between the electron recoil band and the nuclear recoil band. On the top is events from a tritium electron recoil calibration. So the blue shows the mean and plus or minus one sigma of the nuclear recoil band. The red shows the mean of the, sorry, I think I said nuclear recoil, I meant blue corresponds to electron recoil. The red corresponds to the mean of the nuclear recoil band. So you can see all of the events here are above the mean just about. On the bottom, this is data from our ambient californium 252 calibrations. And you can see again the blue is the mean of the electron recoil band, and you can see the nuclear recoil band lies almost exclusively, with the exception of a few events, underneath the mean of the ER band. And again, overall, our discrimination with 50% nuclear recoil acceptance was 99.6%. So we do very, very well in terms of telling electron recoils apart from nuclear recoils. And this is just the leakage fraction of electron recoil events below the nuclear recoil band mean. Again, we do very, very well in telling the two apart. So charge and light yield in our detector was modeled using the noble element simulation technique, or NEST, which is a software package that some of our collaborators on Lux have developed. There is a paper, there are more papers now, but this is the biggest paper that was dedicated exclusively to that. NEST is based on the canon of basically all of the existing calibration data that is out there from all of the different sources in the literature. So we modeled our chart and light yield using NEST, but we applied an artificial cutoff below 3 KeV just to be conservative, because there's not been able to be that much work so far in understanding very low energy nuclear recoils below 3 KeV. So we were very conservative here. We extensively modeled our backgrounds in Lux. So we modeled using a JMOT-based package called Luxen, the full gamma spectrum that we expect to see, which is right here, by component even. And we modeled it excluding the region right next to the grids. The black is the data that we took, so the spectrum of all the events in the detector. The red is the sum of all the different components that were simulated for our background model. And as you can see, they match up very, very well. This is a breakdown of where our different backgrounds come from. Most of our backgrounds come from gamma rays due to internal components, most especially the PMTs, but also from the cryostat and the Teflon. So overall, from this dominant source of background, these gamma rays, we expect to see 1.8 times 10 to the minus 3 eV per kV per kilogram per day in our detector. There are other sources. You have cosmogenic xenon present inside your detector, but again, that decays away over the course of your run. So we expect to see very minimal background from that. You have radon daughters that can produce a small background. Krypton 85 can be present in trace amounts in the xenon, which can also produce a background. We had a dedicated facility at Case Western Reserve University, now at SLAC, that removed krypton 85 through gas chromatography. So we were able to reduce that background down by a factor of about 10 to the 5. So overall, predicted from our background model, we expected to see 2.6 plus or minus 6 background events inside our detector. And the total number of background events that we observed in our detector were 3.1 plus or minus 2, so that was consistent. For our web search analysis, we applied only the simplest and most basic of cuts. We started off with close to 84 million events that we saw inside our detector. We cut out not quite a million of those events just due to detector stability, periods of excursion, periods where the fields might have been fluctuating, periods where the electron lifetime might not have been so good. So we cut those out. We cut out multiple scattered events. WIMPs interact so rarely that if you see something interact more than once inside your detector, the probability of it being a WIMP is so low. So we just cut those out. And we applied thresholds to our S1 energy and S2 energy, and we applied a fiducial cut. So after all of this, we start off with 84 million events. We're left with 160 candidate events left in our fiducial volume. But it turns out that the distribution of events that we saw, which you can see here, as they're distributed spatially inside the detector, with this being our boundary for our fiducial volume, and you can see here how the events are distributed in S2 over S1 versus S1 space. So overall, this distribution was consistent with background only, no WIMP signal, with a p-value of 0.35. So we took this information and we were able to set a limit on the WIMP nucleon spin independent interaction cross section. So LUX represents the world's best limit to date on this interaction cross section. We are the world's first sub-zeptibar level detector. Our minimum sensitivity here occurs at a mass of 33 GeV for WIMPs, and at 33 GeV, we are able to obtain a limit on the cross section of 7.6 times 10 to the minus 46 centimeters squared, which is more than good enough to rule out the possible low-mass signals reported by Zama and Kojin and other experiments previously. So this is our first web search result that we published in late 2013. But since then, there has been a lot more work going on with this data. Just in December, so very recently, we put out a new improved analysis of our 2013 data set. So that's what I'm going to talk about now. The first improvement that we made was we had a novel way to do nuclear recoil calibrations. And what we did was we had a Delphi deuterium-deuterium generator that we deployed right down next to the water tank that produced a 2.45 MeV monoenergetic neutron beam that just went directly into the Lux detector. What we did in order to keep the neutrons from being attenuated by the water tank shield, we collimated them with an air-filled PVC pipe that just stuck through into the side of the water tank and ended at the Lux cryostat about 16 centimeters below the liquid xenon surface. We chose this height just in order to maximize the number of useful scatters that we would see, but the height was adjustable so you can move it around. And then the way that we use this to calibrate our detected response is we look for double scatters, even though when we meant to, we expect to see only single scatters. If you look at double scatters, then you can look at the angle between the two scatters, and the recoil energy can be determined just from the kinematics. So we are able to very precisely understand the energy of our nuclear recoil events from this calibration. Overall, we had 107 hours of nuclear recoil events acquired, corresponding to 1 times 10 to the 8 neutrons per second. So we have a very high statistics data set to work with. From this data set, we were able to measure for the first time low energy nuclear recoils in xenon below 3 kVNR. Which is very exciting because we were able to lower our energy threshold. I mentioned on a previous slide that we have this artificial cutoff that we apply at 3 kV. Now our energy threshold is 1.1 kV, so we can really start probing the area of parameter space where we expect to see very low mass flows. This is the charge yield. Black is data points from our calibration. The line is from the Linhart model, and the green and yellow shaded regions are plus or minus 1 and 2 sigma. Here in the middle is our light yield that we expect to see, and on the bottom here is our detector efficiency showing the cutoff at 1.1 kV. In addition to doing these nuclear recoil calibrations, we took an extended tritium calibration in December 2013. Our initial tritium calibration was only 800 millibecquerels. Our December calibration was 20 times that. So overall, we injected, I think I'm actually missing a zero there. I think that should be 170,000 tritium events inside our fiducial volume. So what this enabled us to do was precisely measure the light and charge yield for electron recoil events. So the same thing that we did on the previous slide for nuclear recoil events, we're able to also do for electron recoil events. And we're able to compare the two in order to see how our discrimination looks. We spent a great deal of time characterizing the width of the electron recoil band. I don't want to go back a slide. But what happens at very low energies, if you plot your events in S2 over S1 versus S1 space, the nuclear recoil band and the electron recoil band sort of tend to bleed together. So discrimination at low energies becomes an issue. We were able to really tighten our electron recoil band by studying detector resolution with the tritium recoils and even by event fluctuations. So we were able to improve overall our discrimination power to be an average of 99.81%. And this is just, again, this is the leakage fraction that we see versus size of the S molecules. We were able to also do a new calibration of energy inside the detector. So when you have an event inside your detector, you see an S1 pulse and you see an S2 pulse, and somehow you need to convert the sizes of these two pulses into energy in order to understand your event. So what you do is you look at monoenergetic sources and you make what is called a decay plot. And you basically you fit a line in S1 over energy versus S2 over energy space, and you look at where the intercepts of that line occur. And then that will give you the values for these detector-specific gain factors, G1, which relates the number of photons in the S1 to energy, and G2, which relates the number of electrons in the S2 to energy. And so you can get those gain factors and really understand what your energy of your events looks like inside your detector. This is the equation. This is a relevant equation. This factor L over E takes into account energy that is lost to heat from nuclear recoils, and this parameter W, that depends on your target, but for xenon it's 13.7 eV per quantum of energy that is produced in the interaction. We also made several improvements to the event reconstruction. There was a noise artifact on the order of about 0.2 photons, just a coherent contribution to our noise, to our baseline noise. So we were able to remove that from our reconstructed pulse areas in the PMTs. We were able to better calibrate our single photon area by looking at single electron and small S1 events, which removes a great deal of systematics from our initial calibration, which was just done using pulse LEDs. And we came up with better ways of calculating the size of very small pulses by, instead of looking at total area and dividing by the single photon area, looking at the number of spikes, because when you get down to small pulse sizes, you get sort of discrete photoelectrons that you see instead of one big peak. There was an extensive study that took place looking at double photoelectron emission from the photocathodes of the PMTs. This was by some of our collaborators at IBNL, so that's a paper if you guys are interested, you can take a look at. We used both PMT arrays to estimate S2 size, which is a change from our first analysis. Initially, we used only the bottom array of PMTs to estimate the S2 size because we were worried about nonlinearities due to saturation of the top array. So we were able to get rid of that. We also modeled the electric field near the walls of the detector, because even though we have these field rings going through the detector, you get a small radial field that tends to push the charge inwards by a couple of centimeters as it drifts. So we were able to model that using COMSOL, and we were able to correct for that in our analysis. The last improvement that we made was we did a lot of work on our background. So again, the predominant background that we expect to see in our detector comes from electronic recoils due to detector components and contaminants in the xenon. So what we did was we modeled the background looking separately at contributions from the top and bottom of the detector. We very extensively looked at wall events using the S2 sidebands in order to account for incomplete charge collection that you get near the sides of the detector. And we also took another look at our neutron backgrounds. It turns out that these are very subdominant to the electron recoil backgrounds, so we don't include those in the model. But here are the numbers anyway. We expect to see 0.08 nuclear recoil events from neutrons throughout the entire course of our run. From S1 and S2 coincident from separate interactions within the detector occurring within a similar time frame and the physical drift length apart, we expect to see about one event throughout the course of our run. And we expect to see 0.1 events from Moroni solar neutrino scattering. So the last thing that we did was we included a little bit of extra data. So there were 10 live days of WIMP search data taken after our initial tritium calibrations that we did not include in our initial analysis, so we incorporate that now. We were able to expand our fiducial volume since we've now modeled events near the walls of the detector. So in 2013, we had a fiducial radius of 18 centimeters. Now we're looking at a fiducial radius of 20 centimeters and a fiducial mass of 145 kilograms instead of 118. So there's an overall 40% increase in detector exposure. We also changed the range of allowed S1 and S2 sizes because of our lower threshold that we're looking at. So these are the ranges that we use for that. So these are all of the events in S2 versus S1 space that we saw in our detector using these revised exclusion cuts. Overall, we saw 591 events, and overall, we expected to see 589 events as predicted by our background model.
So two events are consent.
Signal, yay. Yeah, so very, very, very close together.
So is that actually not a problem, or is it possibly so close together?
I think it's fine.
By 591, the square root of that is 24.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the probability for that to happen is.
That seems to peak at zero.
Correct.
Yeah. It's a little bit. Okay.
It's amazing.
Well, maybe there is an uncertainty in the background. What is the uncertainty in the background?
That is a good question, and I don't know enough about the work on the background model to be able to cite the uncertainties on it.
And in order to put this limit, you must know the uncertainty in the background.
It's there. It's in our paper. I just don't have those numbers on the top of my head.
Well, that point is the coronet neutrino, Michael.
Well, regardless, I think it's consistent with not a single. Maybe the big pattern, maybe those two events or something. So this is the money plot for our 2015 result. So we were able to improve by 23% due to our extended detector exposure and extended fiducial volume, our limit for high mass limbs. But even more exciting, we were really able to push down in parameter space our limit for low mass limbs. So this is the wind nuclear cross section limit versus mass of the wind. So in 2013, due to where we placed our lower threshold, our minimum kinematically accessible mass was 5.2 GeV. We did not have limits for limbs below that. Now we're able to access wind masses down to almost down to 3 GeV. So that's very exciting. Just to have a number to compare to, our minimum cross-section limit was 4 times 10 to the minus 46 centimeters squared for 33 GeV limbs. Versus in 2013, it was 7.6 times 10 to the minus 46. So that's a pretty significant improvement. In summary, so 2013, we produced this world-leading limit. We were the very first sub-zeptobarn level WIMP detector. In December 2015, a reanalysis of our data took place and incorporated all of these advances. We incorporated new nuclear recoil calibrations. We incorporated additional high statistics electron recoil calibrations. We modeled our wall events very extensively, so we were able to increase our fiducial volume and gain a lot of detector exposure that way. We improved our single photo electron calibrations and event reconstruction algorithms. And we incorporated this extra 10 live days of data taken after the tritium calibrations. So again, as on the previous slide, overall, 23% improvement for our spin-independent cross-section limit for high-mass limbs, and even better for low-mass limbs. It's very exciting that we're able to push down to 3 GeV limbs. What's next? So, I guess I shouldn't say what's next. I should say what's going on now, because this is all taking place as we speak. LUX is currently in the middle of a 300-day research run. We're doing a blind analysis, whereas before we were doing an unblind analysis. What we're doing is we're salting the data with simulated web events. We are having a factor of four increase in detector exposure. We are doing additional deuterium and tritium methane calibrations. Radioactive xenon backgrounds are no longer relevant. They've all decayed away by now, since we've now been underground for getting on to 3 years. We are working to continuously improve our electric field modeling and our background modeling. We are working also to make our PLR, we use a profile likelihood reconstruction to calculate our limits, so we're working to make that more computationally efficient and handle our nuisance parameters a little better to allow more variation of parameters at low energies. And there is still potential for discovery, so we're going to keep running throughout most of 2016. And then in 2017, we have our successor coming up, the LZ experiment, which represents a collaboration between the Lux experiment and the Zeppelin experiment, which was another campaign using dual-phase xenon-based detectors over in the UK. So LZ is going to be a 5,600 kilogram fiducial volume with a liquid centiliter veto instead of just a water tank. As a new veto, and we're going to have an instrumented xenon skin so we can take advantage even more of this self-shielding property of xenon that I've spoken about. So that's going to be deployed starting in 2017, and that's going to reach the ultimate limit of the solar neutrino background. So I will show you that.
So there'd be eight.
Yeah, so this solid green line is the Lux 2013 result. Our 2015 result is not on this top yet, but that will improve that by a small factor. This dashed green line is how well we expect to do with our 300-day run. And this green line here, pushing all the way down to this neutrino background, is how well we expect to do with LZ.
But considering the present bounds, do you have any room for discovery in the 300-day run? Well, I mean, this is exclusions always, but can you discover anything significantly? So, considering what you already excluded in the 300-day run?
There's a lot of perimeter space.
Not in the sea, I'm talking about the LAX. Comparing LAX 300-day run to some. Okay.
I think there's potential to find something. Especially now that we better understand our lower thresholds and we can focus a lot more on looking at low mass webs. Another thing that we are doing is we are looking at other kinds of physics analyses that we can do with our data, and I think there's potential for discovery there. So one thing that I wanted to mention was we also just put out a paper. I did not speak about this any, but this just came out a few days ago on the archive. We published our first spin-dependent limits, so that is out there. My dissertation was looking at effective field theory operators, so interactions where momentum and velocity affect the interaction. So that is a paper that I am working on currently that's going to come out next few months. We're looking at S2-only analyses, so events that are too small to produce an initial S1 signal, where the S1 signal is below one photon. So that will help us to look at low mass webs. And then we're looking at other kinds of physics, solar neutrinos, axions. There's analyses going on in all of these places as well. So that's my talk. This is an aerial photograph I took of the home state campus that I kind of like. So this is the Yates mineshaft, this is the Ross mineshaft, and Lux is located almost directly underneath the gates right here. Yeah, that's it. Thank you.
Okay, so I think we'll take a couple of questions. People have asked some already during the talk.
Okay, so for the DD calibration, how monoenergetic are the neutrons once they go through the cryostat?
They are pretty monoenergetic. I think what's the number? It's something like only 4% of the neutrons have an excursion outside of, what is it, like plus or minus 0.5 MeV is the number I have in my head. So 95% of the, 96% of the neutrons are between 2.4 and 2.5. There is a paper coming out about the DD analysis as well that's in the works. It's going through internal collaboration reviews right now.
So it seems like your very good energy threshold is a function of having excellent light collection. I was just wondering if you could explain or sort of project how that should degrade as you scale up in volume to LZ. I assume it should get worse. But.
That is a very good question, and I do think it degrades. The number that I have seen for projections for how well we'll be able to do for the lower threshold of LZ is instead of 3 kV, which was our initial run analysis, and 1.1 kV, which was our reanalysis, the number that I've seen is like 6.6 kV. So LZ will not be quite as effective when it comes to searching for lobos.
And then just a related question, how stable is the light collection efficiency? Do you observe that fluctuate over time, or is that always constant?
We haven't seen that fluctuate over time. The electron drift length, the number of impurities in the detector will affect light collection a little bit. And we see that also in the electron drift lengths that we see, but I don't know, it's pretty stable.
I am a very well. I want to see flight 32. I was curious about that law.
This one?
Yeah, this law. Yeah. So the line, the dashed line, is what you use for the analysis.
So the dashed lines.
No, in the bottom. Below.
Oh, in the bottom. Oh no, that is the average. Electron recoil discrimination.
That's the average, I guess it's the average leakage fraction.
Or yeah, the average leakage fraction, yes.
So is this what you use in the analysis, or you use, because if I look at a plot, the first two points are significantly higher than the average. So that's in the region where you are, a small number of photons, so the low mass weight. So you use, depends what you use.
Disappear oscillation.
So that goes into the analysis in the form of a separate efficiency factor that we multiply by our signal model as it goes into the profile likelihood reconstruction.
Yeah.
And I do think, do we? I'm actually not sure if we do that. If we allow that to vary with energy, or if we just use that
average number. If I look at this variation, it seems that this is systematic. You cannot use a straight line. But
yeah, I believe we do allow that to vary with energy, the factor that we multiply by as an input into our profile likelihood reconstruction.
All right, I think if there's no more questions, we'll just.
Could you show the one that you compare the number of background events with signal with events observed? The 591 compared to 589.
This one or the one for
the one that you show the actual distribution of the events.
Oh, yeah. This one.
No? Okay, forget.
Oh no!
I think
this is the right slide now. If you want
No, I saw you.
Okay.
I asked you.
Okay, well, let's thank.